heard so aimless, my fill with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like the stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow is done. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I blame for my own. Just like the blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander astray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the rock for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw.
Welcome, everybody. Would you pray with me? Dear Lord, thank you for gathering us to worship you on this Labor Day Sunday. And thank you for the labors you've given us to accomplish. And as people who have privileged, we ask you to help us to think about the people who labor for us. And be in our, enter our hearts this morning as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let some of the band sit. Welcome, and welcome to worship this morning after that lively prelude to get us started. My name's Bill Davnie. It's my privilege to preside and preach today. There are a lot of announcements to take a look at in the bulletin. This is, of course, the Sunday before the Sunday that really opens things up. So take a look at things that are coming up next Sunday on Rally Day. When we've got a new Sunday school for children, but also Sunday school adult ed for adults as well coming up. Ben's got a provocatively titled course for the adults that we hope people will take advantage of. Also time for coffee and fellowship around the hours of our worship and education. And then on the next page of the bulletin, you will see things about the kickoff for the men's fellowship this fall, a chance to learn more about Trinity for people who are joining, who will be interested in joining or just knowing more about the church. The fall retreat is coming up later in October, but it's good to plan ahead, and it's time to get signed up for that. You can, it says click here, which won't work on the paper, of course, but you can figure out how to do that on your electronic version. Which you may want to update for that. Forewarning that during the sermon, it will be good to be able to look at the scripture text, the Luke passage. So we have that in the bulletin paper or on your phone. We will celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion today, the Lord's Supper, and we are continuing to use these As Judah said last week, not entirely satisfactory, but they function. All-in-one communion plastic things. So if you didn't pick one up on your way in, I have some here to share. Or if I could ask the ushers to wander with the basket and make sure everybody's got what they need for, anybody else? Anybody else need, just raise a hand. We've got ample. I've got, that would be fine. And there's a basket in the back also. Anybody who needs one, just raise your hand and we'll be ready to go when the time for communion comes. And with that, let us rise and mask ourselves for singing our opening hymn, number 509, All Who Hunger Gladly, Gather Gladly. Join me in prayer. Within this space, in this time set aside for worship, we turn to the mystery of God, our source of vitality, joy, and love, companion of peace, provider of strength, bringer of comfort. Link our heads and hearts this morning. In remembering all our acts done which fall short of God's standards, we recall moments we failed to be mediators of God's love in thought, speech, and action. By your grace, may we continue on our journey of faith, learning to be more Christ-like, gladdened and heartened by his example, and resting safe in the assurance of God's enduring love for all creation. And on this Labor Day weekend, we give thanks for the vocations that have called us to work, be it in offices or at home, in making things or providing services. For in our work, we join with you in exercising creative power in the world where we have been placed to live in your service and glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I'd invite the children to come forward for some time with them, and then I'll remember the announcements I should have made earlier, like the pads, the registration pads in your pews, to put those to work and indicate that you are here, that you are perhaps new or would like to be in contact. I think there were some prayer concerns being identified during that first hymn as well. Any other announcements I forgot to make? Someone speak up if I did. Okay. Ah, excellent. Good morning. Did everybody start school already? And when you started school that first day, did you see any people from last year's class? Is anybody in a totally new school? Are you? No? Okay, so everybody, you saw some friends from last year, was that nice? Because maybe you hadn't seen them much over the summer. Were there any new kids? New kids that you didn't know yet? And how did you get to know them? They sat at your table, okay. And did the teacher have you all give your names and talk about yourselves and all that? So do you think you're gonna make any new friends this year with them? So you're not gonna let them just sort of be stuck in a corner feeling like nobody's paying attention to them, right? We're gonna try and be friendly to new people. Because have you ever been new somewhere? Brand new, was that kind of hard? Sometimes it can feel awkward because you're not sure who to talk to. Making new friends, being nice to people who are, especially when they're new and they might not be real comfortable yet, is a lesson that Jesus taught a lot of people in the Bible, that they shouldn't take care of just their own family or just their friends, but they should reach out and let everybody know that we're all God's children and God wants to take care of all of us and have us know each other. So when you have your beginning weeks of school this year, I hope you'll remember that welcoming new people and being nice to people you don't know isn't just a nice thing to do. It's what Jesus teaches us to do. And one of the things we learn when we come to church like this. So can we have a prayer about that? Dear God, we've all been new sometime, and we've not known exactly how to handle that. But we've learned. And there are new people in our classes and in our lives, and help us to help them handle being new as well, so that we can all know that there are people that love and care for us and show your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Off to godly play or back with your folks.
And everybody, would you please stand and sing with us, "How Great Is Our God"?
Benediction.
The Old Testament reading today is from Psalms. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. This is the word of the Lord. The gospel reading today is from the book of Luke, chapter 14. Now large crowds were traveling with him, and he turned and said to them, whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000. If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. They throw it away. Let anyone with ears to hear listen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Dana. You can pick your friends, but you can't pick your relatives, goes the old saying. Blood is thicker than water. But thicker still, Jesus suggests, are the bonds that bind all of creation. And so he calls us not to some sort of separation in order to follow his way, but rather to turn ourselves outward to include all whom God created as our brothers and sisters. Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Christian worship, pretty obviously, centers around the Bible. Traditionally, the worship service consisted largely of Bible passages and elaborations on those. Psalms for calls to worship and hymns. It was a day when Presbyterians only sang psalms as hymns, and some conservative Presbyterian groups still do that today, the metrical psalms of an earlier era. Sermons, especially Protestant sermons, are expected to have scripture as their base and apply that scripture or explain the passage for the listener's benefit. So far, so good. But Scripture, the Bible, is not a single text. It has histories and creation stories, prophetic critiques of the government, explanatory letters, advice on daily living, and occasionally some actual theology, like the book of Hebrews. Even the Gospels, which I usually focus on when I preach, have stories, the parables. They've got lectures, the Sermon on the Mount and similar, and miracles, some sort of healing usually, and they've got various kinds of sayings and proverbs and such. And because the Bible has all these different sorts of passages, readers of Scripture and preachers need to handle them differently. The last time I had the chance to preach here at Trinity, back in July, the gospel for the day was the very well-known parable of the Good Samaritan. And I mentioned that for the preacher, such a well-known text isn't necessarily a gift, because everybody knows it and you're trying to find something new to say. But it certainly had the advantage of being a single story, a coherent narrative that we could watch develop step by step in Jesus' dialogue with the lawyer who wanted to inherit eternal life. Today we have a much different passage, one that combines forms of teaching and kinds of instruction, and I would suggest some unrelated stuff that Luke's editor should have dealt with before letting the gospel go to print. So while a few weeks ago I could deal with the entire passage and we could dig deeper into the message it sent, today I'd like to do something a little different. I want to go through how I responded to this passage and came to decide that its real message for us today is to look beyond our familiar settings, our family, and onto God's broader world. So feel free to pull out your cell phone or find the spot in the paper bulletin with the text, because we're going to go through briefly some of the chunks of it. But to start with, we would all do well to remember that the Bible did not come with chapter and verse marks, or for that matter, even paragraph separations, or much in the way of punctuation. Biblical Greek didn't have that stuff. The verses that we have today weren't established until about 1560. So a millennium and a half, people had been talking about the Bible without this nifty thing of chapters and verses to refer to. Now, some divisions in the Bible are pretty clear-cut, like that story of the Good Samaritan. You can really tell where it begins and ends. Or the parable of the lost coin. But even a lot of the New Testament doesn't separate neatly into coherent passages. And I'd suggest that today's passage is one of those, even though the church has sort of made it into a coherent passage, whether it really is or not. So let's go back a couple of thousand years and ask Luke how he put his gospel together. And Luke is happy to answer our question, because at the beginning of his gospel, he tells us what he's doing. Since many have undertaken to compile a narrative about the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, I too decided, as one having a grasp of everything from the start, no lack of self-confidence here, to write a well-ordered account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may have a firm grasp of the words in which you have been instructed. Now, we don't know exactly what Luke's referring to here, but it sounds like there were a number of gospels or collections of stories about and teachings of Jesus, perhaps in written, perhaps oral form. So while the ones we have are sufficient to know about God's plan and the message of Jesus, it seems like we probably don't have everything, and apparently don't need everything. We have more than enough to reflect on and ponder what it means to follow the way of Jesus. But we do well to be modest in our assumptions of complete knowledge. And then Luke says he is writing a well-ordered account, which is to say he has a lot of stuff and he has put some order to it. But some of his order makes more sense than others, And I'd suggest that in today's passage, Luke had a bunch of spare parts that he sort of pushed into place. And as the church has used this passage over the centuries, we may have lost focus on one key point by trying to homogenize all of this into a single message. Now, what do I mean by that? If you're looking at the passage, you will see that the first verse just gets us started. There's a crowd and Jesus teaches. Happens a lot in the Gospels. Verse 26, though, gets our attention. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Now that's one for the ages. Whatever it means, and we will return to it shortly, it clearly says something dramatic and important. The next verse, whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple, could fit with that. Hate your family, get up and go follow Jesus. And that's the verse that has become the dominant focus for this passage in the interpretation across many church writers. Every commentary and preaching resource that I consulted in thinking about this Sunday made every verse in this whole passage support that line as the central theme of the passage. But does that actually make sense in relation to other parts of Jesus' life? At the cross, Jesus commended his mother to the care of the disciple whom Jesus loved, generally assumed to be John. His brother James was active in the early church and considered the first bishop of Jerusalem. This hardly sounds like a man who hates his family. So letting verse 27 define this entire passage seems to me ill-founded. And then we get to two short stories. The first has to do with planning your building budget well, the other with not overestimating your army when you prepare for war. Now these both sound, if they were separated from the rest of this passage, they sound like something out of Proverbs, or perhaps out of the famously practical letter of James. We have here examples of what we moderns call wisdom literature, a perfectly legitimate kind of teaching that rabbis, and Jesus was a rabbi did a lot of this. But reminding people to make sure they have enough money before starting a project doesn't really sound like the Son of God bringing the good news of the incoming rule of the God of creation. Nor does it fit much with the verse about hating your family. The next story about suing for peace before getting clobbered by a force twice your size is another piece of good advice. And in fact, we've heard Jesus give this kind of advice before. In Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus tells his listeners, come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him. Or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. So, good advice. Certainly worth paying attention to in our litigious society today. But it doesn't seem to have much to do with taking up one's cross or hating one's family. And then we wrap up with giving up all one's possessions and this incomprehensible verse about salt losing its saltiness. Neither seems to have anything to do with hating your family. Now, my point here is not to diminish Scripture. There are other things that we could dig into in this passage. But it is to say that the church can get in a rut about how it understands certain passages. And Christians can readily insist that Scripture means something they really want it to mean, when sometimes we need to parse the text a little more carefully. So let's go back to that verse about hating your family. A message that sounds so strange that it's no surprise, perhaps, that preachers and scholars have tended to leap over it to the next one about carrying your cross and calculating the cost of discipleship. Now, to start with, we have to ask, how do you understand and translate forms of speech, in this case, hyperbole, that don't always translate well into another language? Some of you are old enough to remember the leader of the Soviet Union pounding his shoe on the desk and saying, "We will bury you." And most Americans took that as a death threat. "We will kill you and bury you." But in Russian, which I later learned and used in Moscow, it's an idiom that simply means, "I will outlive you. I will be at your funeral." Not that I will cause it, I will just be there. "My endurance will exceed yours." Hebrew and Jewish culture were also filled with idioms and hyperbole. We hear that Abraham's children will be like the grains of sand or the stars in the sky. Fine poetic speech, but hardly factual. Jesus talked of a rich man going through the eye of a needle. An obvious impossibility, but a great figure of speech. The parable of the mustard seed growing into a tree for birds to nest in makes a great image, but it's lousy botany. So what's going on with this bit of hyperbolic speech, the call to hate one's family? In the societies of Jesus' time, Jewish, Greek, Roman, and for that matter, in every society until modern times, life alone was simply impossible. The tasks of making food and tending the fire and hunting game and making clothing could not be done by any one person. In American lore, Henry David Thoreau lived his noble, solitary, reflective life at Walden Pond. Except he took his laundry home to his mother every week. Because it wasn't a very long walk, and he didn't know how to do it. So it seems unlikely that Jesus actually expects people to hate their family, and even life itself, to follow him. But Jesus often uses hyperbole, which by definition means exaggerating a point to capture attention when the actual meaning is something more complex, more nuanced. Jewish society at the time was a largely closed community in one sense, yet divided even within itself amongst the various sects, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Zealots, the Essenes, and more. Distinctions that Jesus was rejecting as he sought to bring his people to a more expansive grasp of the incoming rule of God, the formation of the beloved community that was not limited to one clan or one school of thinking or one village. In a time of social stress, oppressive Roman rule, increasing numbers of Greek speakers moving in, burdensome tax collectors, in a time when people tend to react in fear by pulling in, retreating to the familiar, blocking themselves from the uncertainty of new possibilities, Jesus' call to hate one's family was actually a call to his fellow Jews to come out of their narrow loyalties to the broader community of God's creation. We don't see Jesus reaching out yet to Gentiles. That's us, the non-Jews. That only comes in the book of Acts, when Peter grasps the inner meaning of the gospel message. But that call to turn the church outwards begins here, in that curious verse using a word, hate, that could not possibly be meant literally, but which in the richness of language and metaphor points us to the inclusive and expansive community that God envisions for this world, for God's people. Who will the children reach out to of the new kids in their class? Who will you reach out to this week that you might not have otherwise? Who will you include in the unlimited reach of the God who brought you here this morning? Amen. Let us rise and mask and join in singing hymn 515, I Come With Joy to Meet My Lord. Some of whom we know, obviously, part of our community, some of whom we don't know, be they relatives of someone or friends, or be they the refugees or the migrants or others. So a time of prayer is a way not to hate our family, but to remember that we live as part of something far greater than our family. And it is that heavenly community, that divine community, that gathers at this table, whether physically present or spiritually present. We all share in the bread, we share in the cup, and we are reminded that all of us are God's children, and it is our call to bring that news and enact that news to all. This is the joyful feast of the people of God. They shall come from east and west and from north and south and sit together at the table in the kingdom of God. This is not a Presbyterian table. This is not Trinity Church's table. This is the Lord's table. And all who feel called to respond to Christ's invitation are welcome. There is a place for you at this table,
whether you have ever communed with Trinity before and wherever you are on your faith journey. You are welcome, period. Would you join me in the great prayer of thanksgiving? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God our thanks and praise.
It is right, it is good, it is joyful to give thanks to you, God of mystery and miracle. When there was only darkness, you made light. When we cried out to you from captivity, you claimed us as your own. When we forgot our love for you, you did not forget us, sending your prophets to turn us around and renewing your promises with a bow in the sky, the parting of the sea, your own son. And so we praise you, tuning our voices to the angel songs, joining all those who praise you on earth and in heaven with these words. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Thank you for Jesus, for his teaching and healing, his challenging and feeding, his living and dying and rising, that we might be raised with him and all the world made new. We gather at this table because on the night when he would be arrested, Jesus gathered his friends and companions, and they shared a meal together. And as they did so, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to God, and broke the bread, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this remembering me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to God, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant offered for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you eat and drink," he said, "do it in remembrance of me." Pour out your Holy Spirit on your people gathered here, O God, and on these gifts, that we might be Christ's body to your world. For this world, we now pray. End all war, mend your wounded earth, heal those who suffer, comfort those who mourn, and infuse us with your peace that is rooted in what is just. Through the power of your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with one another as we work and wait in hope. It is with thanksgiving that we take this bread and juice, gifts of the good earth, offering ourselves as a living sacrifice dedicated to your service. Amen. The bread of heaven. Take and eat and feed on it in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. And the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. Take and drink and keep you to eternal life. Would you join me in the prayer after the supper? We give you thanks, O Lord, for once again you have filled us with good things, not just bread and juice, but your very self. Now may this glimpse of your kingdom sustain us, give us eyes to see you at work in every place, and strength to be your body in the world. Amen. We have been given these gifts to nourish us in spirit. We've been given many gifts in our lives that allow us to sustain ourselves, our family, our community, and Trinity Church. As Carol plays the offertory, let us take time to reflect on what we have received and how we give to care for the world that God has given into our care.
Thank you.
The hymn tunes we have had on the keyboard are both shake note tunes, from 19th century America. They come out of a particular style of church singing, which I'm particularly fond of and am delighted that they were chosen today. I had nothing to do with that. But you will get, so we've gotten to sing and then hear a version of that second hymn, and the postlude will be the postlude on the tune of the first hymn, right? Lovely, and it's delighted. I'm enjoying having the variety of music we get to have in this situation, both the keyboard and the more contemporary. A brief prayer of offering, and then we will join for our last song. Will you pray with me? All that we have, O God, is but in trust from thee. May we know the graces we have been given and learn how to respond in gratitude. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And our final song, Trading My Sorrow.
Please stand and sing with us.
Oh,
Please be seated. The last verse of that second hymn. Together met, together bound by all that God has done, we'll go with joy to give the world the love that makes us one, the love that makes us one. Go out this week and see how you can share that message from that strange verse in Luke today, knowing that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit remain and rest upon you. Amen.